Lord, we thank you for your presence that's in this place, Father, and we thank you for the unity. We thank you for the unity of the saints, Father, those that are hungry and desperate and thirsty that have come into this place, Father, together in unity, Father, to touch heaven and to have heaven touch them, Father, to go to a deeper place in you, to go to a new illumination, a fresh, glorious place in you, Father, a glory to a glory, a transfiguration to transfiguration, oh God, till we are completely and totally in your likeness and in your image, and we look like you, we act like you, we walk like you, and we talk like you all the time, Lord Jesus. Oh, Father, God, we praise you. We thank you, Jesus. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were in one place in one accord. And I was hearing this as this song was being sang. They were in one place in one accord. The unity of the body came together. And out of that unity and out of that prayer and out of that fellowship, the birthing of the church of Jesus Christ that he had just paid for. The Holy Ghost suddenly, there's a rushing and a mighty wind. Cloven tongues of fire came and set upon every one of them. And they began to speak with tongues. Hold up. No, there had to be translation because you can't speak in tongues in church without translation. The church started that way. It started with the tongues, and then the preaching came afterwards, and everybody was speaking in tongues. It wasn't one person, two people, three people in the place, and then one or two or three interpreted. They all began to speak with tongues. And you're not taking Pentecost away from me. You're not. You can get out your pencil and your pad, and you can try to figure out God and the way he does things, and look at a few scriptures and try to cram everybody into a box that you like, but I'm not going in your box. I'm staying with the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, because the church was birthed out of people that came together that were desperate and hungry and were in need of the promise of the Father. And we're in need. They here again in chapter 4, they got in need. They got in some trouble. They got busy about the work of God. And they got threatened because a lame man got healed. And so when they came back and they told the church of how they were beaten and threatened, they began to pray. The church began to pray because they knew on that day of Pentecost when they began to pray what happened. The glory of God showed up. The Holy Ghost showed up. Hallelujah. Woo! Hallelujah. The Holy Ghost showed up. Oh, and then again. Again, this is later on. This isn't on the day of Pentecost. This is a typification of what we're to live in. Because they begin to pray that unity of the Spirit, that unity of coming together and putting aside man's thoughts or thoughts that the enemy would try to bring any kind of division, put away anything that doesn't belong to the Father, and that's division. Put that stuff away. Come together in unity for one purpose, to see God manifested in his glory revealed, that the nations of the earth might come and see who Jesus is, because there's a people that are willing to put aside their life. They realize that they are dead, buried, and raised up together with the Most High God. And their life is not their own, but they're bought with a price. And so they don't live by their own ability. They don't live by their own thinking. They don't live by their own thoughts of the way things should be. But they come together in the unity of that body, that church, that body, that church, that body, that church that he's told us to come together even the more as the day approaches, not come together the less. Apostasy, as I heard one young minister say, apostasy is when people stop having church. When they go back and, you know, okay, well, you know, a lot of people aren't showing up on Sunday night. So the preacher comes under the influence of what the people, the will of the people, instead of being that candlestick, holding that light bright and standing firm and not being moved by what men do or how men would sway, but stand. A people that will stand and will not back down. He says, come together even the more. He didn't ask if you feel like it and you have time and you're not sick and you're not, and what are you doing sick anyway in Jesus' name? Healing is children's bread. What are you doing with this or that or the other wrapped up in this life, getting all entangled in the affairs and the cares and the riches and the pleasures of this life? What are you doing that anyway? Our purpose isn't these natural, temporal things. Our purpose is the kingdom of God. And when God's people come together, the suddenlies happen. When God's people come together in unity with a focus that we are going to touch heaven, we're coming together to touch heaven, to see the glory of God revealed, to see God manifested in us. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
This is the purpose that your church comes together. To see the glory of God revealed in the place. For every member of the body to function in its purpose, in its part. Everybody's supposed to come together functioning. Not just Pastor Mark when he comes up here, but everybody functioning in your place, in the operation that God has given you, what you've pressed in for and you've taken a hold of. And I will tell you that every one of us in this place are missing out on some of the things that Father would have for us because we haven't pressed in and taken a hold of and possessed those things. Not that they're not there and they're not ours, because they are. But we have to labor to press in. We have to be serious about taking a hold of what God's given us. We have to possess it. Just as the Israelites had to go up and take possession. There were giants in the land. They were breathing out saying, you can't come in and take this. You know, 10 of the spies went up and said, oh, it's too big. The other two came back and said, we are ready because we know our God is able. But 10 of them were afraid and made all of the company of the people afraid. And they wouldn't listen to the two righteous preachers. The preachers, the ones that heard the word of God, who did not have fear or dread of the enemy because God said, I will fight your battles for you. Ah, the battles will come and they'll be there, and it'll look like Goliath on the left hand and on the right hand. It'll look like a big amount of trouble. But God said he fought the battle and he finished the work. It is done. It is settled. Go in and take hold of what belongs to you. It is ours. Thank you, Jesus. It is ours. Thank you, Jesus. It belongs to us. Thank you, Jesus. And so the body just comes together in that place of unity. This is the place to come together and to pray and to say, Father, you hear the threatenings. We need to have some threatenings going on around here, because some of us, people of God are out there getting ourselves in trouble, healing the sick and raising the dead and casting out devils. We need to have some more trouble so we can come together and we can pray. We can get really serious about it. We can see the need of the unity of the body coming together, the unity of that body, his body, the church of Jesus Christ. You know, I think we need to preach on the church of Jesus Christ. Huh? Because this is who we are. This is what Jesus Christ paid for, his body. To go and be the light to the world. His body to show forth who he is upon this earth. Us manifesting the glory. And I just hear the Lord saying, you know, just gather up. Gather up in that unity of the Spirit. Gather up. Press in. Take hold. Possess. We want those shakings. We want those tremblings. And the place was shaken, and they were all, not one left out. There wasn't anybody in the place. Everybody in the place was like, forget about everything else. We've seen the glory of God. We've tasted and we've seen. And now we're pressing in for more, to possess more, to take a hold of more. For, you know, because when he came, they were endued with power. And in chapter 4, they were endued with power again. And that was a continuance in being endued in the church. You know, chapter 4, the place was shaken and they all began to speak with tongues again in the church. Did they read Paul's writings in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, 13, 14? All of those, did they read all of that? I think they forgot about everything being done decently in order. No, you leave out half the scripture in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 and you get your doctrine all mixed up because there was some man that come along with the devil doctrine trying to stop the Holy Ghost from operating in the church, from being people being endued in the church. This is where you need to be endued. You come together in the unity of the Spirit and we press in, touch heaven, and we get endued with the Holy Ghost and fire. Yeah. All in one accord, praying. And the place gets shaken and they're all endued. I'm looking for the place to be shaken. Did we come to church for just another service? Because, you know, this is just what we need to do and what we're supposed to do, and it's Wednesday night, and we've got to get there, we've got to get to church, we're tired, da-da-da-da, but whatever, we got to, you know, we got to get there, and, you know, maybe we'll get a blessing before we leave, or maybe the pastor won't be too long, we can hurry up and go to bed, get home and go to bed. Or did we come to be touched, to be endued, to be strengthened, to be empowered as we come together with one body and we're going to touch heaven. We're touching heaven. We're reaching in to touch heaven. We've got one purpose, to touch heaven, to see the glory of God revealed, to be endued with power from on high so we can go out and we can be those witnesses. That was the purpose. It wasn't for their own, you know, just tickle me here now. And it's not about that. The next service that you can go to and laugh. Laughter is wonderful, but not about the next laughter. It's about being endued with power from on high to be a witness, to show forth the glory, to see God revealed. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we want to see your glory revealed. Father, here we are. Lord, the hungry people that came a few days before Christmas time, when so many are out about doing their own things, those that were here in the service, that got here and began to press in before service to see, Father, your kingdom come, your will be done in this life right here, in our life as a corporate body, in this church, Father. Oh, Father God, your kingdom come, your will be done, Lord. Lord Jesus, Lord Jesus, we want to see your glory. We want to see your glory revealed, Father, here. Father God, we just thank you, Father, for the manifest presence of your Holy Spirit as we come together pressing in to see heaven revealed here. Lord Jesus, and that you teach us, oh God, to press in, Father, to take a hold, Father, in prayer, Father, with this power, this authority that you have given us, Father, that we not only see the church changed, we not only see the church press through, our families press through, but we see regions press through, Father, because we're willing. We're willing. We're willing, Father God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We're willing, Father God, to cry out to you, to seek your face. Lord Jesus, we praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Glory to your name. Hallelujah. Father, move by your Spirit. Lord Jesus, this is our desire. Father, this is our desire to see your glory. Fill the place, to fill the place, Lord Jesus. Your glory to fill the place. Father, I just thank you that not one person be left out. Lord Jesus, we pray right now, Father. We pray right now, Father, that every person, we agree together right now. Every person in this place just comes together and agrees right now that every person in this place be encouraged and strengthened by the Spirit right now. Father, whatever the need that any person has in this place, Father, it is met right now by your precious Holy Spirit. Father, we thank you that all we do is we ask and we receive. Father, that is your good pleasure. That is the relationship that you established, that you gave to us. You gave to your church, Father, that we ask. And whatever we ask, we receive. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us.
And if we know that he hears us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petition that we desire of him. We know that we have it. If we know that he hears us, we ask. This is the confidence that we have in him, that we know that he hears us. And if we know this, if we have this confidence, if we believe him, then we know that whatever we ask, we have it. It's ours. It's done. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not yet seen. If we don't even see him, we know we already have him because we have this confidence in him. Because we came to him and we belong to him and he is ours and we are his and his banner over us is love. Thank you, Jesus. He loves us. He's covered us with his love, his everlasting love. Thank you, Jesus. Over in Psalms 107, you look at this, you look at the love of God. And I hope if you sit down, you only sit down on the outside, not on the inside. Amen. And I'm going to tell you right now, if something's bubbling up in your belly and about to explode out of you, you know, you don't need a microphone. You can just get up and you can just, in order, by the Spirit, speak out what the Lord is saying. You don't have to be afraid to get up. If something's bubbling up out of your belly, I don't know why I'm saying that, but we were just praying that. The church that Jesus set in order. The church that he set in order is the body functioning together. And we need to function together more as a body and not sit. Jesus, help us. Help us. But you read here in Psalms 107, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good and for his mercy endures forever. Oh, hallelujah. We thank God for his mercy. Because how many times have we had to reach out for his mercy? Oh, thank you, Jesus. And then it's new every morning. The steadfast love of the Lord is new. It's new every morning. It's new every morning. Oh, thank you, Jesus. As the sun is sure to rise in the morning, so is his mercy sure to be new. Oh, thank you, Father. God, you are good. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. So! Whom he hath redeemed from the hand of the enemy. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father, that you've redeemed us and gathered them out of the lands from the east and from the west and from the north and from the south. I already got so loud that my voice is kind of cracking up on me. They wandered in the wilderness and in a solitary way. They found no city to dwell in. Hungry and thirsty, their souls fainted within them. Then they cried unto the Lord, and he delivered them out of their distress. Isn't that amazing? He had already redeemed them, but then they got over into themselves. And they got hungry and thirsty. You know why they were hungry and thirsty and just about fainted? Because they had slipped away from his presence. They had slipped outside of the glory. They got over in the natural thinking realm that brought them into the mourning realm and the discomfort realm and the discouragement realm. And why are we out here in the wilderness walking around and what's going on and why did Moses leave us out here? And the murmuring and the complaining began. And Father tells us, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. He says, be thankful in everything, for this is the will of God concerning you in Christ Jesus. It doesn't matter what you're going through, to be thankful. Praise your way out of every situation. In his presence is fullness of joy, and at his right hand are pleasures forevermore. And if you're not in the fullness of joy and the pleasures forevermore, then you need to be getting thankful and back over here in his presence because you stepped outside of his presence. If it's not glory to you, if it's just another day of living a Christian life and a do good and it's not about relationship and fellowship with God, you're missing out. If it's like, you know, yeah, I'm a Christian. And then you just go on about your way, and okay, God, I'm going to get to you somewhere in the day. I'll squeeze you in, you know, because that is my Christian duty. And it's not about a relationship and fellowship and waking up and saying, good morning, Holy Spirit. Oh, Father, you are so amazing. Lord, God, I just worship you and I praise you and I thank you for this day. And I thank you, Father, for what you're going to do in me and through me and out of relationship and fellowship. If it's not about that, then you've slipped over into a meager existence of
a religion and you're like the Laodiceans, that they thought that they were rich and had plenty of goods and were in need of nothing and they didn't know that they were naked and poor. That is the defined religious ritual relationship. They think they have everything and they're fine and they're going on about their business. Not to say that they weren't saying long prayers, because the scribes and Pharisees, boy, they could just let out the prayers. They had the long things to say, but it had no relationship with the Father. There was no relationship there. It was all about how they could say something that sounded good to make them look good in front of all the other people, that, you know, they had used their ability to take everything that they could put together to make themselves look righteous. And they had lost relationship. And then they were naked and destitute and in need. That's the lukewarmness. That's religious ritual. That is a place that we don't want to be. We want to be in that relationship and fellowship with the Father, not a religious ritual. And so they got this, got there, but look at this. In their distress, they cried unto the Lord.
Yep.
And he delivered them out of all their troubles, all the distress. And he led them forth. Look at this. He led them forth. He delivered them. They were murmuring and complaining, but they cried unto the Lord, and he delivered them. Oh, yes, God. And his mercy endures forever. Oh, he's good. He led them in the right way, that they might go to a city of habitation. Oh, that men would praise the Lord for his goodness. Oh, that we would just stay in the praise. We would just stay in the thankfulness. We would just stay in the glory. We would just stay in the pleasure. If we would just stay there, we wouldn't get caught up in the situation. We would just stay. Oh, that men would praise the Lord, for he is good and for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. For he satisfies the longing soul. Amen.
Amen.
He satisfies the longing soul. There is nothing that can satisfy your soul but him. And filleth the hungry soul with goodness. This is our God. Our God, such as sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, being bound in affliction and iron, because they rebelled against the Lord, against the words of God, and contemned the counsel of the Most High. Therefore, he brought down their heart with labor. They fell down, and there was none to help. Then they cried unto the Lord.
Amen.
The same people. They went about their own religious way again. And then they cried to the Lord in their trouble. And he saved them out of their distress. He brought them out of darkness and the shadow of death. And he broke the bands asunder. Oh, that men would praise the Lord.
Amen.
For his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. For he hath broken the gates of brass and cut the bars of iron asunder. Fools, because of their transgression and because of their iniquities, are afflicted. Their soul abhorreth all manner of meat, and they draw near unto the gates of death. Then they cry unto the Lord in their trouble, and he saves them out of their distress. He sent his word, and he healed them. Oh, Jesus. God, are you good? He sent his word. Anyone in this place that needs to be healed, you just receive it. You cry unto the Lord.
Yes.
This is the confidence that we have in him. If we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. He hears us. We are under this new covenant, the covenant of the blood of Jesus Christ. We've been washed. We've been redeemed. They lived for the promise. And yet when they failed and they cried to the Lord, he heard them again and again. Psalms 107 is just unbelievable. If we look at it and we go, wow, how when God was so good to them. And God's going, yeah, wow, when I'm so good to you, why? Oh, but he's good. But he's good, and there's no reason for us ever to get distraught or ever to get discouraged, because we serve such a good and merciful God. And this is the mercy that God shows us, and this is the same kind of mercy he wants us to show everyone else. Because when we were sinners, yet Christ died for us. When we were broken down and miserable and his enemies,
doing stuff like this just against him, rebelling against his word. You know, we look at the men of God that God uses on earth today, and so many people have something to say. They want to know a man. They look at a man after the flesh, and they don't look at the man, the gift that God has placed in his church, after the spirit. They don't look after the spirit. And I was talking to David today about it, and I'm like, it's just like it was with Isaiah. All they could see was Isaiah. All they could see was Jeremiah, a person, a human, you know, a man that looked like them. Yeah, he was a prophet, but how's he going to know so much? All the children of Israel could see was Moses. He looked like a man just like them. And so, you know, today people see a man and they're just like, you know, what do I got to listen to that? You know, I can hear from God. Can we not hear from God ourselves? Huh? Well, then why did God place in the church apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers for the perfecting of the saints? For us to obey them, to listen to what they got to say. Because we look at the people that didn't listen to Moses, and we look at the people that didn't listen to Isaiah, and we look at the people that didn't listen to Jeremiah, and we look at all the trouble they got in, and we think about how dumb were they, and, you know, how dumb. And then we look here, and we see a lot of people that don't want to listen too. Well, maybe we don't see a lot of people that don't want to listen because they stayed home. Seems like a lot of people stayed home tonight. But that's okay. No, it's Christmas holiday, and a lot of people are gone. But we're here, and we're hungry, and we're thirsty, and we want heaven to touch us and to fill us, and we're so thankful for his mercy. And it just goes on about the mercy of the Lord enduring forever and it never ceasing. He's so good. He's so merciful. But how about going on and stepping in to that place of relationship and that fellowship that he paid for us to have? If we look over here in Hebrews chapter 10, you know, people, so many people in Christianity, they're like, they got to get people saved so they can go to heaven. And that's all good and wonderful, but they're missing out. They're missing out on the whole, on a big majority of the point. They're missing out on the whole point. Because if you're just getting saved to go to heaven, it ain't going to work. You won't get there. Because it's about relationship with God. He brought us into, look here. Let's just look in Hebrews chapter 10 here just a minute. We could just read this whole chapter. And let's just go ahead and start at the beginning and see what all. For the law, having a shadow of the good things to come. It was a shadow, it was an image of what was to come. It was a likeness of what was come, but not the very image. Can never, with those sacrifices which they offered year by year, continually make the comers thereunto perfect. For then would they not have ceased to be offered, because that the worshippers once purged should have had no more conscience of sin. But in those sacrifices, there is a remembrance again and again of sin year after year. So there's not that confidence and that boldness. There's a remembrance of what they did. There's not the washing away and the cleansing. It's a sacrifice of, you know, and then the ability of the law. Law was man's ability. And Paul was like, why go back? You know, in Galatians, he's really going after this. Why go back to your ability, the law, when we've been set free and we've been brought over into the liberty of the Spirit? It's the Spirit life. When we are trying to live it out by our ability, it turns into religious ritual. It turns into law. It turns into do-goods. It turns into, let's see, I need to give to the poor. I need to give to church. I need to go to church. I need to press my time card. I need to, this is what I got to do. You know, God, I want to make heaven. I want to do it right. You know, I want to lay down. Oh, God, did I do it all right today? You know, the Spirit comes and brings revelation. of who he is. It's a fellowship. This is what, right here. For it is not possible for the blood of bulls and goats that they should take away the sins. Where, I've got this so marked up I can't even read it. Wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he saith, sacrifice and offerings thou wouldest not. Sacrifices and offerings thou wouldest not. Sacrifices and offerings thou wouldest not. It's not about what you can sacrifice and offer. All that comes out of the Holy Spirit saying, do this, do that. It's not about a sacrifice and offering you can come up with, because it's all finished. It's a finished work. It's a done work. And now we're to follow the Spirit, not a ritual. We're to follow the Spirit. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. But a body hast thou prepared me. In burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin, thou had no pleasure. He didn't have any pleasure in it. Then said I, lo, I come in a volume of a book. It is written of me to do thy will, O God. That's what the Spirit enables us to do his will. To do his will.
Yes. Yeah.
It is written of me, I come in a volume of book to fulfill your purpose. Jesus came and he fulfilled his purpose to bring us back to fellowship with God. He came and he did it all. And you think about the preparation of him coming. You think about him at 12 years old. He knew who he was. At 12, he knew that he was the Son of God. It was already revelation to him at 12. He sat in the temple for 2 days and taught the scribes and the Pharisees. And they're all sitting there going, captivated. And his mom and dad, after they realized they lost him, 48 hours get back to him. 48 hours later, get back to him and say, son, why did you do this to us? And he just looks at him and he speaks out these words that just, you know, they just thundered into Mary and Joseph's heart. Don't you know that I'm about my father's business? He knew who his father was. And with that, what does the scripture say? He went and he was in subjection unto his parents and to the age that the Jews would allow you to be, come into the ministry, come into your calling, 30 years old. At 30 years old, he was in subjection to his parents until he was 30. Forget about 18, people. Forget about 21. I don't care what society says. You are to be in subjection until you step into the ministry, and the Lord might have to say something to you to go somewhere and your parents don't get it. It's just like when we came to California, David's parents couldn't get it. They didn't understand that. You know, to them it didn't seem like a missionary going to China. I tried to explain to them, I was like, look, if we were missionaries going to China, yeah, but it's so expensive to live out there. Why do you guys want to go live out there? It's expensive and it's this and it's that. And I'm like, it isn't about how expensive it is. It's about what God's put in our heart to do. We've got to obey the Father. Yeah. And so at that time, you know, there may be some things that your parents don't get, but Father releases you into going and doing other things. You know, and from that time on, Jesus wasn't going talking to mom and daddy about what to do. But that was from the point of him being in the ministry and about the Father's business from there on, and it was just a focus. Total focus. But then we have from 12 to 30 that, you know, people make movies of Jesus doing miracles and creating birds out of the dirt and causing them to fly. If they would look at the Word of God, it very clearly says where his first miracle was. He turned water into wine. And if you want to talk about intoxicating wine, you're out of your mind. Because we can go into Isaiah and we can look at where the wine, it talks about the wine being in the cluster of the grape. Yeah. It uses the word wine about the juice being in the grape. Yeah. There is no fermentation in the grape. And on top of that, we can go over into Proverbs, and it says when the wine moves in the cup, and I'd like to get over there in all of that and talk about that, but... when it moveth in the cup, I think it's Proverbs chapter 23, verse Anyway, it's right in there, chapter 23. But we're just going to go there. I'm getting sidetracked here. But it so aggravates me because it's taking over. It's taking over the church. It's like, not only do the ungodly get intoxicated, but the Christians, so it's chapter 23, verse 30 through 32. And hopefully I get back over here in just a minute. They that tarry long at the wine, they that go to seek mixed wine, look not thou upon the wine when it is red, when it gives its color in the cup, when it moves itself aright, when it has that bubbly and fizzy. Don't even look at it, much less sip it. Because it's going to bite like a snake. And it's going to make you read on down, it's going to make you look like an absolute idiot.
That's true.
And then it's going to take a hold of you. And when you convince me that you can touch that stuff and you can drink it, and then you can go on and you can make all of the decisions that you need to make after drinking that stuff, just one cup, that you will make all your important decisions about, you know, you're going to make out your will, you're going to, you know, sign papers about your house, and you're going to make all your important decisions after you've drank one cup of wine. When you can convince me that you've got it all together to do that, I'll convince you you don't, because it's still a lie. And you still ain't going to get me to believe it. Because you're just nuts. A Nazarite couldn't even eat grapes. It's not that they couldn't just drink wine. They couldn't even eat the grape. So, I mean, people are just, they're just off in the loony bin thing, just listening to the deception of the devil. You know why? Because the light's come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds are evil. Because, you know, along with it, it's so clear right here, just in this one passage, it's so clear right here that they drink it and it bites like a snake, and then they're off making an absolute fool of themselves, and then they get it all together and get all cleaned up and what did I do, and then they go do it again because they can't control it. You know, and the taverns that put spirits, they really tell the truth. Because evil and spirits are invoked. You know, it is the devil's copycat of what we're given by the Holy Spirit. It says, be not drunk with wine wherein is debauchery, but be filled with the Holy Ghost. The devil's idea is to go drink wine and look like an idiot. And God's idea is be filled with the Holy Ghost and be illuminated with all of heaven.
Amen.
Come in. And take hold of the things of heaven. But the spirits are invoked with anything that is intoxicating or any kind of a drug that takes you on any kind of a trip of any kind, even for a moment. There's evil spirits invoked in that. And you want to denounce that and renounce it and get away from it and have no part of unfruitful works of darkness. And you want to reprove those that do, regardless if they like you or not. They may not like you, but when they need some truth, they're going to know who to run to. Because they know, remember, so-and-so tells the truth. We don't like to hang around him, but buddy, we're in trouble and we better go see what he's got to say or she's got to say. It's the way it is. And then you can just pray that God opens their eyes that they can see. But we'll get back over here in Hebrews chapter 10, and I don't know how I got off on that, but there's so much more. There's so much more to our relationship and this fellowship that Jesus Christ paid for. Then people saying, okay, then pray this prayer so you can go to heaven. No, pray this prayer so you can come on in.
Amen.
So you can come on in to fellowship and relationship with the Almighty God. That's what it's talking about here. So you can come in and that you might know him and that you might behold him and that you might see him and that he can take you from glory to glory, that you can be illuminated from one illumination to one the next illumination, that you can be enlightened, that you can see that there the height, the breadth, the length, the depth
and the width and all the knowledge of God can be revealed to us by the Spirit. This is what's going on. So we can take possession of all these gifts, so we can have everything that He's commanded us to have. You know, again, Pastor Mark, on Sunday night, you know, he said, give us this day our daily bread, and the healing being the children's bread. And I've spoke on the healing being the children's bread so many times, but it came into me again, and it just, boom, that is my bread. Yes. You know, and I usually say the Lord's Prayer. I usually say the prayer that the disciples pray, the prayer that Jesus taught His disciples to pray every day, because there's so much in that. And I just go over it every day. But then again, there's just so much that we can receive. And of that, my daily bread is healing for my body. I forgive those that forgive me. That I forgive those, so Father forgives me. And if I don't forgive those that trespass against me, then neither can my Father, which is in heaven, forgive me. So then, you know, Father keeps us humble and walking in humility and humbleness, that we can't ever get puffed up. And, you know, sure enough, somebody's got to do something to keep us in that place of brokenness and humility, to where we just forgive, you know, and we bless and we curse not. Because I tell you what, if you start cursing, you'll receive a curse. You start speaking something bad about somebody else, watch out. I've watched people say stuff about other people, and I'm like, I wouldn't say that. I've just rebuked them and said, I wouldn't say that. I would not say that. You should keep your mouth. And they just keep, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, you should keep your mouth shut, because, you know, I'm just going to tell you. I'm over here, and I've done this more than once. I'm just going to tell you. When I've seen people say stuff about what other people are doing, I find that they go through the same thing, and they usually flunk real big. So hopefully you can connect to keep your big trap shut. Just mind your own business. Bless and pray for people. You don't think they're doing it right? Then that's for you to intercede for them and say, Father, oh God, you see, and Lord Jesus, we want to see this broken through for them, and just love on them and reach out to them and bless them and minister to them, not come along and go, blah, 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 and if I was out, I would never do that. I wouldn't act like that. And then I watch them act the same way. And I'm like, I want to go over there and say, blah, 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 but I'm keeping my mouth shut. I mean, you think about it. I'm keeping my mouth shut because I don't want to. I said I told you so to David a few times, and I ate that crow. And I mean, I had the direction of the Lord. But when it all happened and all came out like I said, I had to open my big mouth and say, I told you so. So I got some told you so's too. And that's just what, you know. I'm not Anne. I had to learn the hard way on a lot of things. I'm more like Pastor Mark. We're related. My mom was a feisty thing. She was a little general wrapped up in a ball. Everybody might have thought she was quiet, but I mean, anybody that raises six kids while your dad's off on the evangelistic field all the time and always gone, that's one strong woman. And she ruled and reigned. And we believed her. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Above, when he said, sacrifice and offerings and burnt offerings and offerings for sin, thou wouldest not, neither had pleasure in them which were offered by the law. Then said he, lo, I come to do thy will. I love that. Oh God, I come to do thy will. Jesus said, God Almighty said to the Father, I come to do your will, oh God. So we could do his will. He enabled us to do the will of the Father, because he came and he was our example. He was our high priest. He came and he submitted himself to an earthly man and woman, knowing that he was God, the Son of God. And he submitted himself from 12 years old to 30 years old to an earthly man and woman until God released him from that. He was in subjection unto them, preparing himself for that day when he would step out and show forth who he was and his glory being revealed. And I mean, it's clear, his brothers didn't even believe in him, because I mean, like we lived with him for 30 years. And what's going on now? It took a while for them to come around. Mary probably had to do a little bit more talking to him too and reveal some things. It's amazing. Oh, hallelujah. And every priest standeth daily ministering and offering oft times the same sacrifice, which can never take away sins. But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sin forever, sat down on the right hand of God from henceforth, expecting till his enemies be made his footstool. For by one offering he perfected forever them that are sanctified. Is that some good news?
Yes.
That is some good news. One offering, he perfected those that are sanctified. Who sanctified? Anyone that says, the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses me and washes me and sanctifies. I receive this offering. I receive the offering for my salvation. Now I'm sanctified, perfected, one time, done, settled. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. For by one offering, he perfected forever them that are sanctified. Wherefore, the Holy Ghost also a witness to us. For after that he had said before, this is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts. I will write it on their heart. I will write it. He wrote it on our heart. We don't have to look around to be able to know him. We have that fellowship and that relationship of knowing what is right. He leads us. He guides us. It's so amazing how, you know, we start to walk into a direction and the Lord's like, no. And we just know, we know good and well not to go over there. And, you know, when we're babies in the Lord and we don't get the relationship all the way, or we just don't, you know, we don't quite get everything, we step over there in those places sometimes. And then we have that, all of a sudden the lights get turned out and misery's on the inside and you're like, what happened? You stepped over there and the Lord was saying, no, don't go over there. But he teaches you. He teaches you not to walk over there. He teaches you not to get over there in the misery. And then you're just right, way back, you know. And then, you know, some people, they mess up and they get into all this condemnation. But you know what? His mercy endures forever and ever. They cried unto the Lord and he delivered them all of their trouble. Oh, hallelujah. He's so good. He's like that. He's good. And then you grow up and you're not a baby anymore and you don't step over there because you know, it's just like a little child when they're walking, you know, and they begin to walk and they begin to learn to do stuff, you know, like the babies. We've got babies right now and, you know, in my family of grandbabies, and one of them, he's just really tall for his age, and so the brain's not caught up with the height of him, and he can reach on top of the stove. So we have to be really serious with teaching him. It is hot up there, and we have to be careful to help him to not get over there where it's hot. That's what the pastor does. That's what the evangelist and the apostle does. Keeps you from getting up there and touching the stove when you don't have any business over there. Too big for your britches. And you think you're going to get up there and touch the stove because it all looks good and mama's touching it. But you don't know how to touch the stove. Hallelujah. But God's good and his mercy endures forever and ever. And you learn not to do that. You learn to hear the voice of the Father. You're learning how to hear that voice. You're learning how to stay over here in the realms of his presence, in the realms of his glory, where it's all good. And how not to go out anymore. I will put my law in their hearts, and in their minds will I write them. And their sins and their iniquities I will remember no more. Thank you, Jesus. Now where the remission of these is, there is no more offering for sin.
Yes.
Having therefore, brethren, boldness. This is what he did. This is what Jesus did. He didn't die so one day we would go to heaven and we would escape hell. He died so we could come back into fellowship and relationship with Father. So we could live out the destiny that he purposed us to live out. When he created man to live out the glory and the splendor of God-likeness. We were created in God-likeness. We were created in his image, in God-likeness. Do you look like your mom and dad? Is there a resemblance in your body to your earthly mom and dad? There's a greater resemblance to the Father in your spiritual man. He died for us to live out the spirit, not the letter of the law, the God-likeness, that we come in boldly before the Father. And we can be like Paul, have a lot of stuff going on because we have an abundance of revelation. This is the place that prayer, this is coming before the throne of God in prayer. This is where we want to be in prayer, realizing that we have to, oh God, please have mercy upon us. Oh God, have you but boldness to enter in. There may be tears as we're crying out and we're pressing in, maybe for the souls of other people. But Father's bottling those tears, and they're good tears, and it feels like glory on the inside. It doesn't feel like misery. I tell you, I have never prayed and it felt like misery on the inside when I got done. And if people are miserable on the inside when they get done praying, I don't know who they're praying to. I don't know what's going on with them. Because when I pray, it's glory.
Yep.
Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. When I'm talking to the Father, it's good. Yeah.
All the time.
By having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter in to the holies, the holiest by the blood of Jesus Christ. Enter in where the priest himself could only go, that one priest that was set apart to go. Nobody else could go behind that veil. And he had to go, and he had to be perfect, and he had to be sinless, and he had to do everything right, and he couldn't do anything wrong. He couldn't make a mistake in the way that he brought in the offering of blood. He couldn't do anything that was out of order. And Jesus, that one sacrifice, enabled us to go behind that veil that was rent in two and enter into relationship and fellowship with Father. This is why Jesus died. To establish his church and to bring his people in to that place of fellowship. For us to live in this fellowship. And then out of the fellowship comes the glory of God manifested upon the earth through us. This is the co-laboring with Jesus Christ the righteous.
Amen.
Glory, hallelujah. It's fun. It's good. And I want more.
Amen.
By a new and living way, which he consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say his flesh. Hallelujah. That veil was representing his flesh the whole time. The whole time that veil was up there was representing his flesh, that his body would be broken and that veil would be broken into, and it would come down, that we could come back into that fellowship that Adam took away from us through his disobedience, that we don't have to live in disobedience any longer, that we don't have to live in sin, that Satan is not our taskmaster, that we don't have to come under his bondage any longer, but we're free to walk in holiness and purity and righteousness and to be like him. Woo! Hallelujah. And having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience. Done away with. Evil conscience, done away with. Done away. Evil conscience, gone. There is no more consciousness of sin. We're free. We're free. We're free. All of that stuff behind us is not even who we are.
Amen.
And it's so awesome to see people that are in their sin and they get enlightened by the presence and the power of God and who he is, and they accept the blood of Jesus Christ to cleanse them from all sin. In a few years, you can't even imagine the ditch that they were dug out of. You can't even think that that was ever that person. They're such a new person. They're not the same anymore. Because old things are passed away. It's forgot about. And God doesn't want us to bring it up. He doesn't bring it up.
Amen.
The devil brings it up. If you did something wrong and you asked God to forgive you of it, God forgave you of it. And he doesn't bring it up. He never comes and smears it in your face
and says how bad you are. Bad, 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 bad. You messed up. You're just a failure. You're never going to be able. You did this. You blah, 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 blah. Psalms 107 makes it clear about his mercy. They cried unto the Lord, and he delivered them completely out. And he didn't go back over. That's the devil. The devil's the accuser of the brethren. God's not the accuser of the brethren. And if you're listening to accusations about some other person, you're listening to not God. People think they're getting revelation from God. Oh, a word of knowledge. No. The accuser of the brethren screaming, what you listening to him for? You belong to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You're supposed to shut him down. You're supposed to cast that thing down. You're supposed to bring that stuff under your feet where it belongs. You're supposed to know the devices of the enemy. Well, we're learning. We grow. We grow in this. We grow and we learn how to only listen to the voice of our sweet, beloved Father. We'll learn what his voice says by the word. The word confirms the voice of God. And if it's not in the word, it wasn't the voice of God. If it's not what the word says, how the word says it, and how the word has it laid out, it's not the voice of God. There's so many people that they get saved and they get in the word. You know, I knew this one guy, you know, he got saved and he loved God. He was excited about God, but everywhere he went, he was like this. You take him to the grocery store with you. Whatever you did, he was like this everywhere you went. And the problem here is, I mean, not that the word's not good, and that's not good to just really want to keep the word, but the next thing you know is because you're not going around like this, all of a sudden, these people that just got saved become super spiritual. And all of a sudden, they have the revelation of the word that you don't have. And suddenly, it just gets bigger and bigger. And their head's about this big. And they know about this much. Even though they're walking around like this all the time. You know, we've lived this thing a long time. I was baptized in the Holy Ghost when I was 5 years old. I've been in this a long time. I've seen a lot of things. I've learned a lot of things by stubbing my toe really hard and hitting my head up against the wall. And I've learned a lot of things by just being obedient and following the voice of the Master too. And I've seen a lot of things, and out of that, you know, God uses these things in maturity to help perfect the saints. There's a maturity, but see, he gives us the Holy Spirit to lead us and guide us in all truth. But there is those that lead us. And if God hasn't put you in the place of the apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher, you need to be in subjection to an apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher so you can get perfected in these areas. Not that the Holy Spirit won't lead you and guide you, because he will. But you're going to hear some other voices. And you've got to learn how to discern those voices. And there's some people that's been in the way just a little bit longer than you. They've walked with God a little bit longer than you, and they've learned what voices to hear and what not to hear, because they've learned how to line it up with the scripture, and they've learned not to take one scripture and go, but to bring it all together. And like I told the women, you know, last time we met, I'm like, I could take you in the scripture, and I could convince you of doctrine. And by the time I got done, you would be convinced that this was the doctrine. And, you know, I'm thinking of a certain thing, and I'm not going to bring it up, because then your heads would go off on that, and you wouldn't stay with me. But anyway, I could convince you of the doctrine. And then, you know, and every one of you would just go, yeah, you know, that's, I see that in the scripture, you're right. And then I could turn around, and I could shred it to pieces. Because I take the whole word of God and bring it together. And then you go, oh, wow. Well, I wouldn't be able to convince Stuart and a few other people here. You know, there'd be a few people that would just like, oh, no, wait a minute, let me get this all straightened out. Let me help you here. But, you know, for the group I had, I probably could, you know, just bring them all in to my new doctrine that Pastor Mark doesn't teach. And you know why he doesn't teach it? All right, because it's not the whole word of God brought together to make you understand. You know, and that stuff is there for those that are going to just get high-minded and go off on themselves. Yeah, yeah. And not be under that authority.
so you can learn to be under authority.
Thank you, Lord.
To be safe.
Yes.
I don't know why I'm off on that, because we just have such an amazing group of people here tonight that just love the Lord with all their whole heart. Let us hold fast. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. Let us hold fast, for he is faithful that promised. And let us consider one another to provoke one another unto love and to good works. Because love, when we see our brother stumble in an area, doesn't go, I told you they were having some problems over there now. But love goes over there and says, over here is Jesus. And just loves. Love will cover a multitude of mistakes, mess ups. Above all things, have fervent love one for another. See, because God loved us so much that he sent Jesus. And that's the whole of God. And that's what he tells us to be like him, to love one another. Above all things. Above everything that you do, above all of your knowledge, above all the things, above your giving. You know, people talk about, pressing in to be able to give 50% of everything I make. Or, you know, all these people that, you know, Welch's grape juice, the man started that, you know. He was able to come to a place to give 90% of everything and live on 10%. God wants us to give 100% of ourselves. Yes. How about let's say I'm pressing in to give 50% love. We're supposed to be able to give more than that. Or how about pressing in to give ourselves to prayer? We don't have time to give prayer because we got to get over here and we got to work really hard to be able to give 50% of our giving in the offering. How about 50% of our time in prayer? You know, let's spread it out everywhere. How about 100% of walking in the love of God? And we'll see the glory of God manifested. And then he'll supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory. Press in for who? To be like Jesus. 100% of the time. Thank you, Jesus. 100% of the time to be like Jesus. He's done the work so we can have it, so we can walk it out. He says, if you name my name, if you say that you're mine, if we say that we're his, then we should walk even as he walked. But you know what? That's not a have to. That's a whole relationship matter. If somebody's trying hard, they're going to find themselves over like the Laodiceans. You may say a good prayer, you may preach a good sermon, but where's your relationship? Where's that fellowship? Where's that communion? Where's that being like him because you've been in his presence? You can't help but to be like him. You can't help but to talk like him. You can't help but to walk like him because you've been with him. You've been with the Master. And you're going from glory to glory. Because it's his glory. Because he says, come over here. Lord, I'm too busy working because I got to be able to give more in the offering. And, you know, it's good to give. I'm not saying that. But, you know, we look at this and, you know, we talk about that a lot. But do we talk about giving ourselves to prayer? Coming over here in the fellowship and giving ourselves to love, and giving ourselves to miracles, and giving ourselves to utterance, and giving ourselves to tongues, and interpretation, and giving ourselves to the gifts of healing, and giving ourselves to all of the gifts that God has given for us to live in, and the package has been sitting there for us to open, and we still haven't even got over to it to open it. Because, you know, and one reason is we really don't think that we can possess it. We think only some people can. We can have all we want in God if we'll press in and take hold of it. That's hard to look at sometimes. But it's just staying in His presence. And it's being like James said, like, you know, Elijah, he was a man like us.
Yes.
You know, it talks about the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Availeth much. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man. You know, you think prayer and supplication. Effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. And then it goes, Elijah was a man like us. And he prayed that it might not rain. And it didn't rain. Right here. In verse 17. Well, verse 16 is the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Elijah was a man subject to like passions as we are. And he prayed earnestly that it might not rain. And it rained not on the earth for the space of 3 years and 6 months. And he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth brought forth her fruit. He was a man just like us. And he pressed in to possess. And that's it. Pressing in to possess. How much do we give ourselves to the things of the kingdom, and how much do we give ourselves to being able to live out our life? Are we dead, buried, and raised up together with Him to do His will? I come in a volume of a book. It is written of me to do Thy will, O God. That's what Jesus said. That He, and the whole deal is He enabled us to do His will. He did the will of the Father so we could do the will of the Father.
Amen.
You know, you thinking about, you know, Pastor Mark was talking about Sunday night about Jesus saying, I and the Father are one. If you've seen the Father, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. And then I was just like, just exploded in me. It exploded in me, John chapter 17, that they might be one as I am in you and you are in me. So then we're supposed to be able to say, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father, you've seen Jesus Christ, you've seen the Holy Ghost because they live on the inside of me. How much do we give ourselves to what He's done? That oneness of where do we really step out? And are we really able to say, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. You've seen the Son. Do we really comprehend and possess what He has done in that oneness that He has made us with Him? It is ours. It belongs to us. And I tell you, there's some confidence in comprehending and knowing and receiving and believing and participating with what He has done.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Now, I just feel like everybody in the place needs to get up and come forward and participate in what He's done. Let's come together in unity and pray together as a body. And we can start out praying for this church and every person that's supposed to be in this church, that they are in this church, that the hindrances that have come against them are broken.
Yes.
The resistance that the enemy has tried to bring out against people and against the church is broken. You know, if we press in for hindrances to be broken out of our life and us to take possession of the things of the kingdom, and we press in for hindrances to be broken out of other people's lives and for them to press in and take a hold of the kingdom, and we press in, we begin to press in for more people, we begin to press in for people to get saved, and we begin to continue on with that, then we can press in and we can take dominion over regions.
Amen.
Over cities.
Amen.
Over regions, over nations.
Amen.
Through prayer.
Amen.
And that's what the Holy Spirit started out. You know, I had no idea where I was going to go with that tonight and what the Holy Spirit was saying, and I was just listening, having a good time. Because Father is calling His body to that unity, to pray with one mind by the Spirit, to see a change, to see a change, to see the glory of God revealed. And that's just what I hear the Father saying is, you know, us come forward. And it's not the loudness or the quietness of your voice, but it's the Holy Spirit just praying through you And you know, my husband, he doesn't pray really loud when he's praying and he's talking to the Father. And I wish everybody could have the pleasure of being in on a prayer meeting with my husband. If you have a prayer meeting with my husband, he'll be praying and you won't get a prayer in edgewise. Because he just lost, and all you can do is just sit there and, hey, man, oh, thank you, Jesus. Oh, yes, God. Yes, Lord, amen. Thank you, Jesus. Father, oh, yeah, oh, Father, that was good, Lord. I wish everybody could have that pleasure. Not, you know, I'm not trying to brag on him, you know, and him, because he's quiet about it. And you know, to have that opportunity, you know, everybody's not going to have that. I mean, I got to marry him. So, I get to be in on that prayer life and that faith and that determination and that stand that he has with God and that refusing to be moved. And I mean, he fell and broke his arm a few weeks back, and he fell off a roof onto a ladder. The ladder slipped and he fell behind the ladder and hit his elbow. And I mean, it was obviously broken. Big old knot came up on it immediately, black and blue. It was really nasty looking. He was in severe pain. And the kids are like, Mom, he needs to go and get that thing x-rayed, man. That's bad. He needs to go get it x-rayed. I go, you and whatever team of horses you can get can come over here and you can try, because that man ain't going to no doctor. And I'm like, you can do whatever you want to, but, you know, don't tell me, because I already know I'm not going to even try. So if you want to get a team of horses and you want to come over here and you want to tie him up and try to drag him, go ahead. But then, you know, that was like Friday, Thursday or Friday. And then that next Sunday night, he's sitting in church. I mean, he's just believing God, pressing in and just going on about his business. I mean, he came home, he was a little shook up, but he didn't stop, because he's like, I'm not laying down to that thing. And you know, we're all worried about him. He goes, look, don't put me in the grave. Get away from me. He goes, I'm not laying down to this thing. And, you know, that Sunday night, he's sitting in church and just pressing in. I saw him over there with his hand on it, praying for it. And instantly, God healed it, and every bit of that pain went out of his arm. Completely healed, to the glory of God. But he wasn't giving up. There was some pressing in to take a hold of it. And, you know, we go, Father, we thank you for that. Okay, it didn't happen. Well, we get to looking to our ability, to man's ability. But Father's so good. He's so good. He's so good that he'll teach us to stand and be determined and not to let up or let down. Everybody just come up here. Come together as a body. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. And I'm sure everybody here knows somebody that needs deliverance, that needs salvation, that needs encouragement, that needs strengthening. In Jesus' name. Father, we just thank you. Lord, we just come and we agree together for every person represented here that somebody is interceding for. Father, we thank you for salvation. Lord Jesus, we thank you for salvation for Amy's mom and Brad's mom. In Jesus' name, I just hear that by the Spirit. In Jesus' name. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you take the stoppers out. We thank you, Father, that you take the stoppers out. The mind-blinding spirits that have kept them blinded from the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We thank you, Father, that it is done, that it is settled. In Jesus' name. Father, we go in and we possess and we take. We take, Father, what belongs to us. And the enemy has to get his hands off. In Jesus' name. The enemy has to get his hands off our families. In Jesus' name. You name your family member. You name your friends. You name them before the Father. And we agree together in unity right here tonight. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus, by your Spirit, that every yoke is broken, every lie is broken, every stronghold is broken, Father. We thank you, Father God, in Jesus' name. We thank you. Hallelujah.
In Jesus' name, we take possession in Jesus' name of those things that belong to us. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, every person, we agree together, Father, for every family member, every friend, Lord. May the yoke be broken off of them, the mind-blinding spirit be broken off of them, Father, that they can hear your word, Father, that your word will pierce and penetrate their heart, Father, they will hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. They will be set free from the powers of darkness and the bondages, Father, that have held them captive for so long. Father, religion. Father God, we thank you that you move it aside, Father, that the ears can hear and the heart can receive. We thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord Jesus, by allowing our lives to manifest to you, Father. Lord Jesus, that we say more by what we do and how we act and how we love and how we live than we say with our mouth, Lord. That we show forth your glory, Father, by our actions and our attitudes, Lord Jesus, more than what we say, Father. Lord, it's not about a good argument that we're right and somebody else is wrong. But it's about living the love of Jesus Christ and manifesting the glory. Manifesting your glory. Your glory lived out in us and through us, Lord Jesus. Has everybody named out somebody or somebodies that you know that needs a touch from heaven? Have you named them out? We're going to agree together. We're going to agree together that there's a change or there's a breakthrough. Amen. We're going to agree with Joseph in Jesus' name that there's a breakthrough, that there's a change. Father, we thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
We thank you, Jesus, that you turn things around.
Amen.
Father, that you make the path straight.
Amen.
Father, we thank you that you make the crooked path straight.
Amen.
We thank you, Father God, that everything that the enemy has done to lie and steal and kill and destroy,
yes,
Father, that it is broken in Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
We thank you, Father God, that the mind-blinding spirits, the lies of the enemy are destroyed in
Amen.
Jesus' name.
Amen.
Father, the light of the gospel of Jesus Christ shines bright through us. Father, in wisdom to shine bright.
Yes.
Wisdom to shine bright.
Yes.
Wisdom to shine bright.
Yes.
I tell you, people, if you don't know what to do, if there's a situation and you don't know what to do, you just begin to pray.
Amen.
You don't know what to do because the Holy Ghost, he knows what we have need of, and he intercedes through us. We just let the Holy Ghost pray. We let the Holy Ghost pray, and he intercedes with groanings that cannot be uttered because he knows what the need is. And I tell you, you begin to pray, and then next thing you know, it's coming out of your mouth, the word of what to do, of what's going on, and the revelation. You just, you know, because you're a Holy Ghost person. Then it's the Spirit that's doing it. And you're standing there and you look at a situation, you don't have to stand there and say, I don't know what to do. You stand there and say, okay, Father, in Jesus' name. And you pray in the Holy Ghost, and then boom, up out of your belly comes the answer. Up out of your belly comes the revelation. Up out of your belly comes the need that needs to be met. And so then you know how to pray, and then you know what to do, and then you know how to act. Oh, hallelujah. And so, I mean, it's just like praying for somebody. You pray for somebody, and then the Father begins to pray certain things through you about them, and you're like, oh, and then you begin to pray, okay, Father, do you want me to minister these things to them? And then you begin to pray for that opportunity. And what Father wants you to say and nothing else. Because, you know, the Lord will give us a little something, and then some of us will just explode it, you know, real big. And I know there's been times in my life that if I didn't obey God, and I knew it, and if I didn't just say the one or two things that God had me to say and be quiet, because the Lord said, say this little sentence and be quiet and let me work. And then, okay, now say this and close your mouth and let me work. That's what the Father was saying. And now you can say this and be quiet. You know, but when we get into trying to convince, it almost turns into almost an argument on even just one side, because we're just trying to convince them so much and we just want them to get it so bad. And we're not following the Holy Ghost there. We get us added to it. And then we just push things back. You know, more than anything, people need love. They need to see the love of God. They've heard a lot of talking. And they've seen a lot of things. But they need the love of God manifested to them, and the signs and wonders and miracles and the glory of God. They need to they need you to lay your hands on them, and they see a miracle. Not a bunch of convincing words all the time. You know, if what the Holy Spirit's saying is good, because it's going to go deep down, it's going to penetrate. And God's word is sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing, dividing the soul and spirit, joint and marrow, and discerning the thought and the intent of the heart. So it gets in there. The word gets in there. It goes down into the heart. But it's His word,
true,
not ours.
True.
And we need to wait on Him for His word.
Amen.
And not speak ours.
Amen.
Ha. Because His will break through, and ours will push back. But we're learning.
Yes.
We're learning to say what He says and then hush. And there's times that I've done that, and I've been obedient, and thank God, boom, the breakthrough, the deliverance. And there's times you want to put people in a headlock and just pry their brain open and shove it in there and go, I'm doing you good. But it's, you know, it's by the Spirit, wait on the Holy Ghost. I tell you what, God loves every person that's on our heart tonight. He loves San Diego.
Yes.
And every person that's on our heart more than we do.
Yes.
He loves that closest person to us that we love so dearly. He loves them more than we do.
Amen.
And He's just saying, intercede, pray, seek me, wait on me, speak my word, be obedient. Thank you, Jesus. Don't be afraid to speak His word, but don't add yours to it. Speak His. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. We thank you, Father God. We thank you, Father God, for every soul that is represented here. Father, for every loved one, for everyone that we care about, that we know, Father, that it hasn't come, hasn't stepped into this fellowship and this relationship, this glory. Father, we thank you that the mind-blinding spirits are broken. The deaf ears are unstopped. The captive is set free. Father, bind the powers of darkness. We agree together that the powers of darkness are broken off of these people in Jesus' name, so they can hear the gospel. Father, we thank you that you use us to speak the gospel. And Father, we thank you for the divine opportunity and the words, Father, coming up out of our belly to see the breakthrough in Jesus' name. And we thank you, Father God, in Jesus' name, that you have given us power and authority to possess the lost. Father, you've given us the heathen for our inheritance. And that means the souls of the ungodly. Father, they're ours, and we will inherit them, and we will stand in the gap for them, and we will be the repairers of the breach, and we will be those that are those that restore the past to dwell in. Lord Jesus, will be those that make up the hedge.
Yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
By showing forth your glory and your love and your goodness.
Amen.
And your signs and your wonders and your miracles, because we'll take a hold and we'll possess everything that belongs to us, and we will not be denied.
Amen.
We will not be denied. Amen. We'll have all that you've called us to have.
Yes.
Father God, we won't be asleep in church, but we'll be a sober, vigilant,
church. Father God, putting the enemy on the run. Father God, when we get up every morning, Father, the enemy's running because we woke up. He's scattering. Lord Jesus, when we show up, the demons have to flee. Because the power of God is manifested in us. Because we've been with the Master. We've been with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And every power of darkness has to flee in Jesus' name. Power and authority in your people. Power and authority in your people, Father God. Stand against every lie of the enemy. In Jesus' name. Victory in Jesus. Victory in Jesus' name. Victory in Jesus. Victory in Jesus. we just want to touch heaven. And she's simply talking to the Father. It's just simply just saying, you know, here I am, God. I mean, just be, you don't have to be, you know, say any great words or any great prayer. You just want to touch heaven. You just want to talk to the Father. And when you begin to talk to the Father, He'll begin to talk to you. You'll touch heaven, and heaven will touch you. And that's what it's about. You know, maybe some of you just need to get on your knees and just get quiet. And, you know, just focus on what you're asking God for. And let it just come up out of your, out of the inside. And you'll feel a change. When heaven touches you every time you come to church, then you're taking heaven home. And you're going to a deeper place at home, and then you're coming back to church and going to a deeper place at church together in unity. And it goes from glory to glory for you at a young age. Like if Jesus knew who He was at 12 and He said, I'm about the Father's business, why can't you be? You can. You can. But you can't let the things of this earth occupy you. No more than your parents. If you see the example of your mom or a Pastor Mark or anyone else, they're touching heaven. And Jesus touched heaven. Why can't you? You can. You can. You want to get filled up with the Holy Ghost continually every day, just as well as your mom and dad. And we want to see the results of it when you come up here. We want to see the results of it with all of you. With every person. That heaven's here. And you're touching heaven. He's right here. We're not waiting on Him. He's waiting on us. To just talk to Him. It's so simple. It's so easy. I see some of the kids, man, just getting over raptured in the glory. And some standing around just kind of like waiting for the next thing to do. Father, we thank You, Father, for such a moving of Your Spirit that the children are captivated. The young people are captivated. These young kids, 10, 11, 12 years old, and even younger, Father, are captivated by Your Spirit. Captivated. Captivated by You, Lord. Caught up in the realms of glory, Father, that they can taste and see, Father, that we have come with boldness before Your throne room to enter into the place of glory, to that fellowship. Lord, You brought us back through the blood of Your Son, Jesus Christ, to have fellowship with You. Not to die someday and go to heaven, but to have fellowship with You, to step over into heaven, because we already live in the realms of heaven. Thank You, Father. Thank You, Father God, that we be partakers of what You have done. That we taste and see how good God is. If we're kind of busy about our own stuff, we're not tasting God. But when we're pressing in, and sometimes you have to push through, because there's a lot of hindrances. People are hindered. The enemy's come out to stop you if he can. How about don't let him? How about don't let him? How about get baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire? The fire of the Holy Ghost. The fire of the Holy Ghost. And it's about getting hungry for Jesus. Just being hungry for Jesus. Yeah, right here. What a miracle. What a miracle Santiago is. Oh man, this kid is just precious to me. So precious to me. We thank You, Father, for Santiago. We thank You, Father. Look at that. Look at the joy and the glory hitting him right now in Jesus' name. We thank You, Father, for the power and the glory of Your presence touching him right now, Father, in Jesus' name. Your glory, Father. Your glory, Father. Somebody full of the Holy Ghost, get down there and pray for him. Father, we thank You for Your miracle working power, Father. Complete the work, Father, that You have begun right here. In Jesus' name. The miracle power. Father, we thank You that Elsa's not going to get discouraged. She's not going to look at the circumstances, but she's going to look to You, Lord. You, Father. And all of these things that come out against her to try to stop her and try to push her back, Father, we break the lies. We stand together, Father, as Your saints, and we break the lies of the enemy off. Father, Your people will not be discouraged in this place. We will open our mouth and we will praise You. We will open our mouth and we will worship You. We will open our mouth and we will rejoice in the God of our salvation. We will thank You for Your your goodness and your mercy that never ceases. We thank you, Father, for the anointing. We thank you, Father, for the anointing that breaks every yoke. Father, we thank you for fresh fire of the Holy Ghost. Baptize in the fresh fire of the Holy Ghost. Fresh fire of the Holy Ghost right now in Jesus' name. Fire! 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 Fire of the Holy Ghost. Fire of the Holy Ghost in Jesus' name. Today, Father, thank you. He is so hungry and so thirsty and so passionate for you, Father, that all he can do is see forward and not back. Lord, that he don't look back, but he looks forward, Father. He doesn't look for what people can do to him and how people can be good to him, but how he can be good to people, how he can be your servant, how he can be used of you, Father, to minister your word, Father. After being in your presence, Father, take him up into the realms of your glory and the realms of your presence. Rapture him, captivate him. You know, people, if you'll go into the place of heaven with your children, they'll go there. You don't have to tell them here, you pray. You just have them with you and you go there, and it will teach them to go there. And when you go there at home, it's more powerful because there's nobody else looking. And they know mama's having a relationship or daddy's having a relationship with the Father, and it teaches them how to go there. We thank you, Father, for the anointing right here. And the increase, the increase, the increase, the increase, the increase, the increase. Fire the Holy Ghost. Fire, fire, fire. Satan, it's not about you falling down, but it's about you praying and talking to the Father. Talk to the Father. Talk to the Father.
What Father's saying comes up out of you.
people. If there's anybody that needs prayer, I'll be glad to pray for you. I get big kind of focusing on the kids because we want them to touch heaven. Now, not later. Yes, Lord Jesus. Yes, Lord Jesus. Yes, Lord Jesus. Take him deeper, Father. Yes, Lord Jesus. In Jesus. In Jesus. In Jesus. In Jesus' name. Strengthened by your spirit. In the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name. Strengthened by your spirit. Possess. Possess. Possess everything you've got. Hallelujah. Strengthened by your spirit. Strengthened by your spirit. Strengthened by your spirit. Father, crying out, Father, for the souls of her family. Father, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, we claim these souls for the kingdom of heaven. In Jesus' mighty name. In Jesus' mighty name. In Jesus' mighty name. In Jesus' mighty name. The opportunity to come and worship the Lord with what He's blessed you with. In Jesus' name, we thank you, Father, for the anointing. Father, we thank you that this young man will not go without being prayed for. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name.